So good morning. Thank you all for coming. I wanted also to thank again Carolina for making this possible and making all of it to happen. I also apologize on behalf of Sylvie Berry, who wasn't able to come last minute. So I will talk here today mostly about fuel. So I'm an archaeobotanist interested in fuel use and also in wood use. So you will hear a lot about charcoal today in this presentation. Also with me, Evgenia Zavadskaya, who couldn't come either because she's really far away and really busy. So she's a social anthropologist from University of Blagoveshchensk, who is specialized in Amur events. And Sylvie Berry, who is a traceologist, specialized in Paleolithic period, and she is the real ethnoarchaeologist here, so you won't be able to meet her today. So we're very sorry about that. Okay, so to follow the lead that Carolina put just before when she was making her introduction, fire is something that we are very familiar with, but it's kind of immaterial production itself, and it's the remains and the heat signature that will be that will represent actually the artifact. So basically, in the archaeological record, we are working on heat signature and on burned materials, organic and inorganic. And so we have a number of approaches that are even getting, with time, a better resolution. And we are trying to approach basically temperatures, fuels used, heat processed materials, taphonomy and functioning rhythms of combustion structures. But of course, we encounter a number of limitations which concern the central questions for us of heart function. And well, because of classic issues that we have in archaeology, which is all the taphonomical processes that affect the record. But also, we as fuel analysts, we have a certain number of difficulties to relate the fuel assemblages, to see if there is a relationship between the fuel used and the fire-related activities. So this is one limitations, and these limitations could be linked to a number of factors, but also of the probable polyvalence of prehistoric hearths and so or fuels. So basically, all of the activities can be done with one or two kinds of fuels, and it doesn't really matter. So this is one question. And so the main purpose, the main question we ask ourselves was, when we perform fuel analysis, what kind of data we can reasonably expect, and how can ethnoarchaeology intervene to help in this case? So I specifically work on the late Pleistocene-Holocene transition in different climatic contexts. So some I'm more familiar with, others I'm just beginning. And so I am studying this transition, which is very interesting because it's a great environmental variability. So with context ranging according to the periods and the locations between the cold tundra or shrub tundra to cold and temperate conifer dominated forests. So this wide context allows me to work on a variety of climates and cultures with the objective of trying to go beyond the environmental data, which is traditionally the data we obtain as fuel analysts and more specifically charcoal analysts, and isolate fuel-related practices. In fuel analysis, it has been difficult for us, and we were a little bit behind in what regards human practices. And so it has been long considered that the fuel use of prehistoric hunter-gatherers was an opportunistic selection, which was determined by the environment. And so we have been actually very busy in the 70s and 80s working on charcoal as an accurate proxy for reconstructing past environments. So this is one goal that was achieved in the 80s and the 90s, so that we have specific methodologies who can allow us to actually document vegetation pretty accurately. But this fact actually led also to the idea that if it was representative, so there was no selection of woody fuels. Also, there is this idea that the colder it is, the more crucial fire and heat production become, and so that marginal environments should be the only one that trigger specific adaptative responses. And so basically we are also in a scheme where the use of bone or other alternate fuels is deterministic. As I said, we were behind, so in the 90s, it's the one model, it's the one model proposed by Shackleton and Prince in the 90s, who really are the first ones for us, in anthropology at least, to state that fuel acquisition is highly selective and highly reasoned, well, until it's not. So in their idea is that first people will be settling down at one place, and then they will be very selective, choosing the best species they want. They also have the advantage of introducing for the first time the fact that there can be a differential choice between the state of the wood. So people would go for seasoned wood until there's no seasoned wood left. And so episodes of ruptures would indicate the only moment where potentially firewood collecting strategies would mirror the vegetation. So this is the first model, but in reality, if you look at it another way, this conception of fuel use is also fatalist or deterministic, because at some point there is a rupture and you have no choice but just to use fuel that way. So first season species, then anything that is left, and then you go for green wood because it's the only thing that's left, and then you're obliged again to change and to apply the principle of the least effort. And then following the development of techno-economic approaches in prehistory, which really took a peak in the 80s and the 90s in France, fuel analysts began to adopt this view of human societies, which is more systemic and a little bit more holistic, as interacting entities between people and their environment, so within a broader technical systems. And so that maybe it was possible to highlight techniques and uses of fuel as a means to approach social behavior. In this case, so we would have an open model. It's not just about how, which fuel was there and which one was chosen, but it's an interdisciplinary approach where we are trying to fill in the blanks of one given model, which would be a model proposed by Isabelle Théry-Parisot, where other bioarchaeological data can provide us with clues about the environment. And so we try to determine if some fuels were deliberately chosen or not, because they were probably, so they were chosen probably because of their properties, so their objective properties for on the one hand, which led to explore literature about wood and other properties, and also to make a real effort about experimentation, about combustion behavior of different fuels like bone, etc. And so we are beginning to see that from an objective viewpoint, there are fuels that are less polyvalent than others and that they have specific properties. But also, of course, other human factors which we don't know about that can be also totally subjective. The idea being to see that these systems are open systems that interact with all the other techno-economical subsystems, with the heart in the middle of a lot of technical activities that cross each other. So with other data from archaeology and bioarchaeology, we have to relate given fuels to uses of fire, other activities, taking into account maybe if there are a relationship with site functions, so the activities that were performed on each site and thus seasonality, which brings us to the big question of the relationship between, for example, heart functions and site functions, which could theoretically be there, but we are having trouble evidencing it. So we thought that maybe in order to test this kind of models, we could propose, so it was some 10 years ago when I was doing my thesis with Isabelle Théry-Parisot, And with Sylvie Berry, we had the idea that we could propose a classic ethnoarchaeological approach, classic because maybe it was at that time quite new to try to look at fuel in that way in an ethnoarchaeological setting. But the approach remains classical because the question we are asked is archaeological. So we want to know what environmental and societal information is conveyed by fuel use, or at least fuel remains. So our archaeological observation focus on material culture and its remains, so the artifacts. So all the technical activities, trying to see if there are links between the remains and the activities. The aim being to highlight possible regularities that could have a more general value that are linked to the properties of the materials used, for instance, no? Or for environmental parameters that can be comparable between the past and the present. So this leads us to an approach where the model testing is not only based on experimentation but also on real life, and try to understand in one peculiar context all implications of given activities so we can diversify our hypothesis in the end. And then we try to solve archaeological visibility issues, which means that this information has to be brought back in some way to the archaeology. So between 1992 and 2016, especially Sylvie, but also other authors, like, were involved in a number of projects in Eastern Siberia and North America. So we have a basis where these are ethnoarchaeological projects, but each had its specific aim. So it was difficult to really work on the basis of these informations because they are very rich, they are very diversified, but there is no real homogeneity of what we are looking at. Because in one case, for instance, most of the projects in Siberia were centered around the relationship between humans and animals in their environment. The project Anthropobois, which I had the luck to participate in mostly in interior Alaska, was about the use of plants, but mostly the use of driftwood, also from a woodworking perspective more than a fuel perspective. So when I had the luck to go and work with Claire Alix, which was the director of the project, we could focus more on certain issues about fuel. And so we selected a few places in tundra and taiga where we had some data. So all the data is not homogeneous, so we have different kinds of information. And we selected some data about the projects we are talking, I will talk about today. So, So I will specifically focus on the work I did with Evgenia Zavadskaya in the southern Amur region, or eastern Amur region, because there, this is the place where we tested the model among Evengs. And the other places where Sylvie Berry, Claire Alix worked, she had also the opportunity of making a certain number of observations related to fire and hearths, while the main purpose of her work was as hide working and processing from an ethnoarchaeological and traceological perspective. So we have here diversified environments where we can also test how the use of different fuels are related and so on. So environments ranging from southern boreal forests to northern tundra. So here a quick presentation of the events, but very quick because I don't think we're going to have really that much time. So they're interesting because they are spread on an enormous part of the Russian territory, Siberia, from the Yenisei to the Sea of Okhotsk, as well also as in northern China and Mongolia. So they are very diversified in different territorial groups, which have distinct regional features in history and culture and language. And mostly they are nomad hunters and reindeer herders, but historically also among some groups, fishery, horse, or even sled dog breeding were dominant. So in Amur region today, there are three main groups of Evenks, the Tindinsky, that have, for instance, been studied much lately by Alexandra Lavrillier, the Zia and the Selemjinsky Evenks, where Evgenia and I worked. Together, we worked at the Selemjinsky Evenks, and she worked also among the Zeya. And well, their history is very complex to follow because mostly because their nomadic lifeways are characterized by a very weak archaeological imprint. So this was also very interesting for us to see really if there could be any archaeological visibility at all. And also the very high number of diverse cultural and economical influences over the centuries from other autochthonous peoples, of course, but also the massive Russian influence from the 19th century onwards. So our fieldwork among the Selemjinsky Evenks was made around the village Ivanovskoye. And so among the groups we worked with, mobility is strongly dependent upon the seasonal migrations of their domestic reindeer in the case where herding activities are dominant, but also the mobilities of wild reindeer and other valued games such as moose. So the herders, but also the hunters, own reindeers and they use them for transportations, milk, and sometimes meat, according to the main dominance, economic dominance, if herding or hunting. So in this case, when herding activities are dominant, hunting activities cannot be performed in the same way as for the hunters. So this specific study was made over two seasons. So at the end of the winter, and so in one winter camp. So we can see here the log house is the main habitat during this season. It's a direct direct legacy of the Soviet administration who built these log houses around seasonal nomadization territories, and so now they use it still because it's more comfortable, so this reduced their mobility degree, but basically by the time of our survey, they were nomadizing along the axis of this river, which you have here, which is the Khargar River. And so also traditionally in mountain environments, the nomadization is to take the reindeer from winter where river to upriver when temperatures increase in order to protect them from heat and also to a certain extent of flying insects. So the main group we worked with was a brigade of reindeer herders that owned around 150 reindeer. And so their territory is a strip of about 80 kilometers around the river. So now we'll focus on the observations we made in winter. So when we arrived, it was our first ethnoarchaeological trip. We saw that they were in one house, that they had one stove, that there was so the Russian stove that has been used in this region from the 19th century onwards in the tents as well as in the log houses. And so basically we had one hearth which they used for performing everything that they did there. So they heated, they dried, they defrosted, they cooked. There were no specific, really specialized fire activities in the archaeological term, and the outdoor campfire was not present, and so it's very rare in this region, whereas, for instance, among the Zeya Evenks, it's systematical. So we only saw that, only one species was used, and that 9/10 of the total consumption was dry standing wood, and this was quite interesting because the acquisition territory was no further away than 800 meters. So we had this idea that wood acquisition would have been micro-local. So here we had this example with a small group of people living there for 7 or 7.5 months a year for 20 years, and they still had enough wood to not increase the acquisition territory. And this was basically the most important thing for them. So in any case, seasoned wood was really important, and in the camps where it was not available, but they wanted to go back, they barked the trees so they would die. So this kind of practice where you incise the cambium in order to let the tree die, you have to wait 4 to 5 years to get standing dry wood. So it's a great anticipation. And the people told us that generally, even long time ago, this was a practice that was actually done when people thought that maybe in some years they would go back to the same area to settle. And effectively, as we thought also, green wood is much easier to get closer because it's more abundant. And so it was not further than 50 meters. So the fact that the house was there reduced considerably the mobility of these people, knowing that with the snow, wood transport was anyway made easier, so it was better for them that way, and it was more advantage to keep staying there. Also, if the reindeer had to go further away to get their food, for them it was a good compensation, because in winter reindeer are easier to find and easier to keep, so it was no problem for them. So when we see this, it does not at all reflect the taxonomic diversity of the environment. So what can we say about this? So this is really a problem, because actually the taiga looks not very rich, but it's much more richer and diversified than this 100% use of larch. And so we see that even in the range of the wood acquisition territory, there are species that are avoided because they are shrubs and with the stove, so they don't need to use these shrubs. Also, that there are some species that are avoided because they are not, they say that it is not good for different kind of reasons. But also, the bigger diversity we found was actually in other places that were more far away, and so that didn't go into the, that weren't part of the wood acquisition territory. So in this case, we had the riverside species, because they never went to the river to collect wood, and also the dark needle taiga and the hillside vegetation was frequented all day for other kind of activities, but never for going for wood. So this monospecific assemblage we have of larch would reflect the use of the stove, their personal preferences, but also basically the poor diversity of the actual acquisition area. But because in this acquisition area, basically we had almost only larch. So to a certain extent, it is very grossly representative. So then we decided to see what happened in the snowless seasons. And we had the opportunity to go back at the end of summer or beginning of autumn. So in the moment where snow melts, people get more active, and also the residential mobility increases. And there, where they start using the tent and are no longer in log houses, the four criteria which are known for a lot of that are almost always cited by any event you may encounter for settling in one camp, is the presence of water, is the presence of wood, it's the presence of dry soil, at least for putting up the tent, and the presence of pastures for the reindeer, of course. And a compromise can also be found with including distances to hunting grounds and other such things, but basically the four criteria with water and wood being really important, because wood scarcity, actually, when wood becomes scarce, people can respond by changing, by making a residential movement, and this would be one of the advantages of mobility, because in this season they are not tied to the house anymore, so you can move, and also you can play with the seasons, you can make spring last longer, you can delay winter by staying on the best side and where it arrives later, and for the spring the same, when the spring begins you can go where it begins first, and then you can go a little bit upriver and spring comes again. So that's what they explained to us. And actually in the snowless seasons there was a real diversification of fire-related activities. And we could observe, so at the autumn campsite, wood acquisition distances were quite even more reduced. And we saw hide smoking being performed. So this would be one specialized activity with a monofunctional hearth. It means the hearth and the structure, the nuchinak, it stays there over the year. It can be replaced when it's no longer good, but it stays there and it's used just for this. And also with the arrival of the mosquitoes, you have the smudge fires for the reindeer against the flies. And so they require a lot of attention and have to burn all day. And generally, this is a plus point for the reindeer to keep them coming back by themselves. And also, it's only used for that. And then the outdoor campfire, of course, which is also something that is linked to the better season, that a lot of activities, like cooking activities, can be transferred outside. And so we saw that the activities that were accumulated by the stove in the winter seasons, they would be now between the outdoor campfire where they boiled, they dried, they smudged also. So sometimes they would put more smoking fuels to make like a third smudge fire for reindeer, and then put other fuels when they wanted to cook. They also treated wood and bark there. And then in the tent, they only used it for baked bread or for fry or for the drying of meat. Also, they do it under the tent and for heating when it rains or when it's cold. So in the end, it was a short stay, but we could, between the snowless seasons and the season, see that there were two smudge fires, specialized, monofunctional, where mosses and fresh boughs were added. One campfire, which also functioned as a samnin. Two stoves, one hide smoking hearth, and in the snow seasons, the campsites where we visited and monitored the use of fuel, it was four stoves. And in the end, we had 10 hearths and one species, and it was large. So basically, if we work on charcoal identification with the species, we would have had only large. And so no visibility at all of whatsoever was going on. So then we asked about what happens in the other seasons. What do they do? Where do they go? And which fuels do they use? And why is it so? And so, of course, it was good to ask that question, because when we asked them about that, they specified that the four criteria, and especially one of the four, the availability of wood, most of the time, wood availability meant standing dry larch. So if we transfer the oral information and our GPS points to a theoretical spatial level, the floristic diversity of the anthropological, of the charcoal deposit, does not represent the complexity of everything we saw. Yet the scale of this annual round here, the duration of occupations, they vary a lot. They don't have any influence on the nature of the deposit because it's almost only large. And everything between all these campsites, energetic needs, collecting strategies of wood, number and morphology of different hearths changes. And we don't have this at all, because we have only larch, and they don't even represent the diversity of the vegetation that should be, because of this pre-settling idea that the open larch forest is the best for settling. So in the end, that appeared clearly, because There was one only one single campsite which was located in the mixed spruce large forest, and there we had actually, they told us that they used three species. So basically there is a strong selection. They have 20 ligneous species that are used for different purposes very commonly, but only three are cited as firewood. So in this case we can say that the original initial composition of the vegetation when people settle, they can induce variation in the charcoal results, but the human choices, they are responsible for the distortion that we have. So the good thing about what we saw is that actually they used larch, but they used it in very different states. So maybe this is a possibility to see that actually it is possible, even when you have a longer occupation, you are residentially mobile, so you can choose. You can choose the environment you want with the species you want, and you can play with the states of the wood to perform actually almost, yeah, to perform all needed heart functions. So in one case, for hide smoking, it's very rotten wood. For all the smudge fires, it's green or half rotten, or anything that produces smoke. So in this case, we would have also non-ligneous parts of plants, such as needles and leaves and things like that. And then, yeah, it was alternation between seasoned and green wood in the other cooking fires. So to summarize, we can say that we have a very poorly diversified wood acquisition area because of these preselections of campsites, of the vegetation of the campsite. We have a strong preference for larch. We have a management of the wood in different states, which is largely enough to satisfy all energetic needs. And we have, linked to the modern acquisition techniques probably also and the shape of the hearts, discard of birch for cultural reasons and shrubs for other reasons. So the notion of good fuel is very variable according to the hearth function, according to the type of combustion structures, according to preferences and traditions. So this would be the main distortion factors of the charcoal assemblage, and you have the vegetation of the acquisition territory, which can induce variation when it varies. So when the vegetation changes, theoretically we can see it. But this remains very local, very rough, roughly representative, and heart function is absolutely very difficult to identify. So what happens when we compare to the fuel variability for the context we have this information about fuel variability? So we would have, in all the cases here recorded among Evenki, we have wood and non-ligneous plants. We have the rare use of driftwood. When we go more to tundra environments, like in Kamchatka, where Sylvie worked, we have the use of driftwood because they are a tree line, so it's very difficult to get wood. They can go a little bit further away and collect wood. There are some instances where bone is used in the hearths, and also non-ligneous parts of plants or non-ligneous plants. And in what regards the Alaskan part and the British Columbia part, we have a majority use of wood in the boreal forest zone, some non-ligneous plants, and driftwood is very variable. On the Alaskan coast, of course, it's a very prized resource, but on the interior, it can be very, very prized and expected and seasonally awaited for, and in other cases, it can be, like many events we talked to, very, very negative. And so not very used. So about bone, I will introduce here the work Sylvie Berry did with Virginie Vatte. So she, Virginie Vatte, who worked in Chukotka, and so they compared some of their fire and their hearts they had. And so basically they see that bone is actually put in the fire for pragmatic and ritual reasons. In one case in Chukotka, there are no trees at all, so it's really a cold tundra. And well, in the case of Kamchatka, they have a little more wood, but in both cases, they use drifted wood also. And so what happens with the bones is that they are cut in very tiny pieces and used for making the greasy broth. We have also archaeological testimonies about. Or they are discarded very carefully in the fire. And when people are asked about it, mostly they say it's because, for pragmatic reasons, that the wolves will come and so this is not good. Or they say that they can't give the dogs to the bones because they would hurt them and things like that. But there are also this idea that of respectful disposal of the bones, of the consumption of the eaten animals, because people are not wolves and so they should treat the remains respectfully. And in that respect, this is different from what we observe, for instance, in the boreal forest or in other authors which have worked in interior Alaska, where basically this does not happen because the ways bones are discarded are really different and do not involve fire. And actually, this could be seasonal too, because in other instances, when the snow melts and the water holes become available, this is one way to discard the bones also. So this would theoretically leave a specific signature and we could see it, but we don't know really, because we have a lot of experiments and experimental material, but we don't know how this practice would look like if we sampled such hearts. So, what about the use of non-ligneous plant elements? So this was quite variable also. So this concerns only smudge fires, which have practical but can also have ritual purposes. And so here we have the interviews from the Driftwood Project in Alaska. We have also our own work. We have still the work of Virginie Vatté. We have the work of Donatas Brandišauskas, which couldn't make it, but was supposed also to be here. And so we have, for instance, for practical purposes, so against mosquitoes, but in this case against mosquitoes to protect human people. So in Kamchatka, in Chukotka, they observed the use of dwarf birch. They observed the use of Cassiope tetragona, which is used also, this is interesting because it is used with the fire drill to start the fire. And also in Chukotka, Virginie Vatté observed that for specific ritual fumigations, they would use branches with their leaves, but of willow. In interior Alaska, they use a lot the birch fungus Felinius ignarius because it has bug repellent properties, so you can just put it in your campfire and it helps. And in what regards the evenks, we have different testimonies of the use of many times. It is also like in the case of Cassiope, it is plants from the heather family that are aromatic, so there is a specific smell when you burn it, like Ledum palustre, or also some thyme family. And this is more for the ritual smoking. And as for the smoke against mosquitoes, it can be the needles and mosses of the larch. So here in this case, we don't have also any. Data about the visibility of these practices, but it would be interesting to test it and to see to what extent these non-ligneous fuels could be visible through fuel analysis in these open air context, which do not seem to leave really a great imprint, or could be, well, the idea being to see if there is an anomaly or no that could highlight such practices. And so about the woody taxa used for fuel, there is a big difference between the villages or the places where the human activity is more intense. And you can see it right away when you walk around. In one case, it's very anthropized everywhere. So you would have birch-dominated vegetation, which we also see in palynology when we start working on vegetation history. So in these cases, people do use birch and do use anything that's available, which is more species demanding light because the vegetation is open. And in the places where the impact is not so strong in the boreal forests, it's more the main taxa. So in Siberia would be larch, and in Alaska it would be spruce, white spruce. What is generally preferred is that dry season wood for most activities, except the specialized ones. So we also have a certain number of forbidden taxa, and they are specific. And this, we also looked into the work of Alexandra Lavrillier. And so they are variations which are quite interesting, and we have it so among different group of evenks. So in the Zabaykalia region, it would be more birch. So it's the same as what we observed around Ulgen. But also in some instances, the rotten wood used for smoking hides. And so all testimonies say it's forbidden for a reason. It's because when you are injured or when your reindeer is injured, especially when people are ill, if you use it, there are risks, and there are risks that can be deadly. We have testimonies of people who say that the reindeer was ill and they forgot and they used birch and the next day they died. So this is very serious. And so in Bomnak, where Evgenia Zavadskaya worked, it was also birch, but it was also pine. And where Alexandra Lavrillier worked, it was more pine, but also fir. And in North Baikal, we have one testimony that it was for another reason that it was forbidden to use spruce in the tent because it sparks a lot, and so for them it was dangerous. But in all the cases, we have that rejection that is one of the strongest forms of selection. And so anyway, this is very, we have a certain homogeneity, but in the end, there is great variability and poor visibility for us in charcoal analysis anyway. The only thing that one can say is that logically, environmentally speaking, in the Amur region, in the eastern part where I worked, there is no pine, so it's logic that it's not forbidden. Also, where there is can be a strong selection of species is when you start treating food. So here, for instance, the smoking of fish. So in the frame of the Driftwood project, we had quite a lot of, we have about maybe 50 participants who responded to the questions about smoking of fish because they do it a lot. And so in summer, they go to fish camps and they start doing the activity. And so smoke here really influences the taste. So basically the grease content of the salmon here in this case, or of the fish in general, and the used species give a really specific flavor. And so this is really personal. But we have some coincidences. So in interior Alaska, along the Yukon, they would use cottonwood, they would use willow, they would use alder, and on the coast they would use the brush, or they would use sometimes drifted cottonwood. So what happens when you asked when we ask evenks about it? So they also, this was interesting because they also use mostly riverside species. So again, poplar, again, willow, cherry tree, and also chosenia, which is also a salicaceous species that is specific to this part of Amur region and also more eastern part. And so this was interesting because basically we had a really strong specific selection, as well as in British Columbia, also around poplar. And recurrent explanations according to which softwoods and birch not only give bad taste and horrible consistency, but could be harmful. So maybe there's something here to look for. And so we would have here something very interesting, if we think about it archaeologically, of a strict taxonomical selection, which would highlight this specialized activity of fish smoking. Because the domestic fire is really different. The fuel used in the domestic fires are really different since they are softwoods. So this would be interesting. But of course, there are always exceptions, such as here, the little green star. One family in Stevens Village, they claim that they use any kind of driftwood for smoking fish. So there's that, and we don't have any more indications. And other important limitations would be that basically a lot of the events we interviewed also claim that fish smoking is not something traditional, really. So basically, there are a lot of instances where they just dry the meat, they dry the fish, and the fuel used is any fuel. So for instance, here in our region, they have to keep away the flies from the meat, so it dries a little bit, but not too much. And it's the same thing, it's the same main campfire we saw before. And so in the best case scenario, maybe we would have a type of heart that would be more like the smudge fires. But that's it. So maybe it could be more related here. And so here, for the smudge fires at least, we have only one main purpose, which is to produce smoke, and we have a variability around it, but mainly we have a coherent basis of the use of green wood, which is tricky because green wood is still difficult to highlight with charcoal analysis, but we are trying. And so everywhere you have different practical purpose, mainly protect from flying insects and also protect from predators. So they are a palette of fuels adapted to smoke production, but we can theoretically see them and they are recurrent. And in what regards hide smoking, this was interesting because we have an infinite variability of practices around this, but everywhere where we recorded it in the boreal forest, because it is not a practice of the Yupit or of the Chukchi, in all the places it was the same fuel, even if the general process was always a little bit different, and so it's a very rotten wood. But the great variability in what regards, because most of the time it's a seasonal activity, but it's not the same season and it's not the same. Well, they don't use the same tanning agents, they don't, so there's a big variability, but in what regards fuel, it's pretty coherent. And this has already been seen a long time ago because in the lower and middle Yenisei, the Kokorievo culture, Upper Paleolithic, they had this kind of heart that we also found in Athabasca and British Columbia for smoking, but of course, at the time of the excavations, there were no analytical techniques whatsoever, and so they just used the shape of the heart to conclude that it was skin treatment. And here also we can see that the shape of the heart, of course, is not enough because we have a great variability. We have just really small flat hearts with poor visibility, and these hearts that are well, and a variability that is not really also function of the region, because for instance, what Lavrillier describes for the Tindinsky events, it's more of this deep heart that we find in British Columbia and in the Selimjinsky and Zaya Rayon, we have this flat little fireplace. So basically, this data we presented here, there are only punctual observations that we made a little bit everywhere that correspond to different environmental and socioeconomic contexts. So they are specific examples. We cannot use them per se to interpret a given situations, but this is good because also these observations, they reveal the variability and the richness of specific activities. They also reveal the very little probability of documenting them at the archaeological level. But however, in all the cases we recorded, people make the best out of the fuels that are more easily available. This is compatible with the fact that a pronounced choice of woody fuels exists, especially in what regards the specialized hearts. And moreover, we also noticed that, and this has a more general value for us, that the choice of the species is really made regardless of the state of the wood. So, because the latter has a determining influence on the combustion process. So this confirms our archaeological postulate, according to which the identification not only of the taxon but also of the state of the wood is crucial in order to infer the possible behavior of fire and start working on new things. And in the same way, the use of alternate fuels, in fact, may reveal much more than a simple deterministic use, where before we were almost thinking that you need to hunt to find fuel, bone fuel, because you don't have anything else. So it may reveal seasonal, functional, or other socio-economical parameters, and therefore it would be necessary to increase and diversify multi-proxy fuel analysis in different archaeological contexts, and also start working in on a homogeneous way of doing ethnoarchaeological studies on combustion features. Thank you.